Kind thanks go to Brilliant for sponsoring today's episode. What are the differences between SpaceX's Starship serial number 10 and serial number 15? What are all the changes Musk talks about? And why is SpaceX disassembling their Super Heavy booster again? Let's find out.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Let's light this candle.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? And as always, there has been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. These are some fast-paced times for the space industry. Development everywhere, innovation, funding on an unprecedented level, even from the private sector, and on top of all that, we have SpaceX building the biggest rocket in human history. SpaceX's Starship is supposed to be orbital towards the middle of this year. An internal goal is aiming for July 1st, and even though this might seem very fast, it could still be possible that SpaceX makes that first orbital flight happen shortly after. To achieve this, Starship number 15 is supposed to improve on many things. Hundreds of internal improvements, structural, avionics, engines, software, everything has been developed further to get closer to that final design. I've been busy analyzing Starship number 15 for you to show the visual differences between 10, which was still a Block 3 Starship, and 15, which now, according to my internal classification, would be a Block 4 Starship. The next step in the evolution, so let's do this. Serial number 10 versus serial number 15. Here we are, serial number 15 on the left and serial number 10 on the right for direct comparison. Pictures provided by Mauricio from RGV Aerial Photography. Amazing job! A link to his Twitter and Patreon can be found in the description. Alright, let's do this top to bottom to not miss anything. All the way on top, what seems to be the upper header tank vent has been changed in design. Vents have been moved all the way into the nose tip. Then the handling points at which SpaceX workers attach cranes to lift up the Starship at several stages of construction have changed from a rounded design to an elongated one. Faster handling times will shave off some hours. Continuing further down the nose, weld marks have changed quite a bit. Y-shaped marks that weren't even there on serial number 10 have appeared on 15 and others have been rearranged. This shows that there is quite a bit of internal change here, which other than by the weld marks is invisible from the outside. On we go. Compared to serial number 10, the aerodynamic covers on the forward flaps have changed quite a bit. Different shape and they seem to attach better to the hull. Overall, a much cleaner look. Jumping down to the top dome area where plumbing and all sorts of other details can be found, many things have changed as well. These ports have been added. The Starlink antenna for testing purposes has been added. Directly above it, we can see some V-shaped weld marks again missing on serial number 10 and indicating more internal design changes. And finally, the raceway has been changed a lot. Much cleaner look and with an extra pipe leading into the CH4 tank. I'm tempted to say that the extra pipe might have to do with header tank pressurization. Everything here has matured a lot compared to the rough look on serial number 10. Even further down the hull, following the much cleaner raceway and plumbing, the sensor setup on the hull has changed in many places. Here SpaceX has switched from 1 to 2 sensors. Looking to the side where the aft fins start, we can see major changes on the aero covers. This looks like a completely different design altogether to change the airflow. An extra hinge seems to have been added as well, previously not visible on serial number 10. Jumping back into the middle of the hull, basically everything is different. Silver heat insulation material present on serial number 10 is missing on the cable work on serial number 15. The cables attached to the hull in a position much more to the left. Autogenous pressurization pipes coming from the engines and carrying hot gas from the turbopumps to be fed into the tanks again for pressurization attach in a completely different position. This can be an indicator for a different engine setup or different plumbing inside the engine bay. Since serial number 15 uses a different thrust puck design as well, this change might be connected to it. And again, as in many other places of the hull, different weld marks can be seen on serial number 15 compared to serial number 10, also in the engine section. Again, due to components on the inside added, left out, or positioned differently. That's quite a bit of change. It's going to be very interesting to see how serial number 15 performs. And we won't have to wait much longer either. Aiming for a launch next week. 420 anyone? I guess I'll get everything ready for another epic launch stream. SpaceX's testing frequency is increasing dramatically. As seen on this chart made by Boca Charts on Twitter, the increase in speed can be seen clearly. Where serial number 9 needed 42 days from rollout to launch, serial number 10 needed only 33 days, and serial number 11, 22. If SpaceX launches serial number 15 next week Friday, which would be the last possible date before the weekend, we'd land at 16 days, which would bring the time needed down to a little more than 2 weeks. If it launches early next week, the 2 weeks mark would fall for the first time. Just hypothetically speaking, if SpaceX keeps this frequency up, we'd be talking about another 18 possible Starship launches in 2021. That would bring us to a mind-boggling serial number 33 for Christmas. And that's not counting Super Heavy boosters, which are being produced in parallel right now. Speaking of Super Heavy boosters, we already have to say goodbye to the first one. As it is almost tradition at SpaceX, the first prototype is always just to look at and to do some training with it. That's booster number 1. Never meant to fly, and now SpaceX is already getting rid of it. No transport to the launch site, no obvious handling tests done either, just build and take apart again. And as SpaceX is quick with everything, it seems the booster already has been taken to the scrapyard behind the construction site piece by piece. And another one. It's sad to see it leave like this, but it opens space for the next one. Never get too attached to a prototype, its end is always around the corner. And while booster number 1's end has come, serial number 15 is working on its grand performance, to show the world how much it has improved from serial number 10. First cryogenic testing was done early this week and everything looked perfect. Business as usual. Liquid nitrogen was pumped first into the oxygen tank and then into the upper methane tank, interrupted by several strong vents to stress test the system. Frost built up on the outside, indicating that this was a test at flight pressure with completely filled up tanks. All went well, no problem at all. Long gone are the days when even a cryogenic test would cause stress and hyperventilation amongst us Starship fans. SpaceX knows by now how to build a pressure vessel that can withstand the needed numbers. And yes, they are not building it in a clean room, and yes, it's made like a grain silo, and yes, it all works out in the end. Keep that in mind when saying that SpaceX might not succeed with all this. So far, so good. As said earlier, a launch is expected to happen next week, and I'll of course stream the whole thing again to watch it together with you. Keep a lookout for a stream reminder. Now, let's see what we can expect from a first Super Heavy booster flight and what kind of progress SpaceX has made towards the orbital flight. What do you think about today's episode so far? Liked it? Give it a thumbs up. Didn't like it? Tell us in the comments what we can do better. Subscribe to the channel or even become a member by hitting the join button under the video and get awesome perks like access to our Discord and a chance to talk to me and the team or completely ad-free episode releases for supporters. Or get some fresh Y-Ware in our merch store. Designs from the community including Neo Pork, Nick Henning, Brendan and me. Ready to make you look awesome for the next launch. Thank you for all your support. You rock. Now that booster number 1 is gone, it opens up the way for booster number 2, the first one to actually perform tests. Replying to Adam Klotz on Twitter on March 30th, Musk clarified again that booster number 1 was a production pathfinder, that they've learned a lot and that booster number 2 would fly, maybe even to orbit, and maybe even on an orbital pad and all that by the end of April. Now that sounds like a lot. This is booster number 2, and a huge thank you goes to 3D Daniel from the Y family for providing us with this animation. Well done. Cut in half, it reveals the inside tank structure. Methane on the bottom, oxygen on top. Daniel has decided to give the booster 4 engines as 28 seem to be a little out of reach right now and until the end of April. So if SpaceX opts for 4 engines and a 150 meter hop, this is what it would look like. The internal tank structure is similar to a Starship. No header tanks though, and the main tanks switched. Methane is on the bottom here. As soon as the ignition occurs, the 4 Raptor engines start propelling the booster into the air. In this case, with a slightly different flight profile compared to first Starship test flights. SN5 had asymmetric thrust due to one engine propelling the vehicle. This created a very distinctive tilted flight path. BN2 won't need that. No matter how many engines SpaceX ends up putting under the first booster, they won't have to go with an uneven number, and so the booster will perform a much less tilted flight path. And since all this by now is proven technology, we don't expect problems either, and so the booster lands just fine on the pad. That's it. A first demonstration flight for a super heavy booster and what it could look like when it happens. Do you agree? Is there anything you'd add? As always, tell me in the comments. Neopork has been working on his version of a fully equipped booster as well and has provided us with a render of what it will look like when a super heavy booster is performing the final landing burn. No legs. Still no solid information from Musk as to what exactly the catch mechanism will look like. A tiny piece of equipment needed for booster number 2 has been spotted by Mary, aka Boca Chica Gal, at the construction site. Thank you, Mary. It is the first ever spotted completed super heavy grid fin. Smaller than the initial design, it still is a giant, and in combination with 3 other fins, it will be able to steer a booster when returning back to the launch site. We should see first use of these on an upcoming booster high altitude flight test. And SpaceX is working hard to make it all happen. The launch site right now is one giant construction site with hundreds of workers working on about the same amount of projects, it seems. As seen from the air through the lens of RGB aerial photography, the sheer size of the construction site becomes visible. Several buildings, a new unknown foundation next to the landing pad, the orbital launch tower, and a fuel farm that will be double the capacity of what the suborbital test pads have to offer. The same goes for the old Sanchez site, where SpaceX has been reshaping the terrain for propellant production. Oxygen and possibly even methane will be produced on site to feed the launches. And since we're talking about another possible 18 launches this year alone, the site has to be large. Huge storage tanks are being prepared on site. More and more of the large silver domes are being produced, and recently also the tank walls have started production. SpaceX workers have started producing ring segments at the refinery site. No doubt for the storage tanks, and stacking has already started. Who would have thought that the knowledge of building steel tanks could be utilized in so many places at the launch complex? And the refinery column itself is growing larger and larger as well. There's no doubt that SpaceX is taking all this very seriously. Another amazing site has been filmed by Starship Gazer. A link to his channel can be found in the description. He was in the right spot at the right time to film a semi-truck going down Highway 4 towards the launch site carrying a very special structure piece. This is the first of many segments for the orbital launch support tower to arrive on site. A massive steel construction that in the end will tower around 140 meters into the air above Boca Chica. As seen in the footage, the concrete and steel foundation for the tower is already finished, and now the stacking begins. The square segments will be stacked on top in each corner, forming the frame for the steel construction. In the end, according to Musk, this structure is also supposed to catch boosters and maybe even starships out of mid-air for a safe return. And all this is supposed to be finished by July 1st? Looking at all this, it doesn't seem like SpaceX would have any doubts as to the success of their prototyping program. It just seems to be a matter of time before starships regularly fly to orbit and beyond. Their confidence in something that has never been done before can be seen as something absolutely unique. Serial number 15 is just the next step in quick succession. I would love to see them succeed. Let's cross our fingers for serial number 15, booster number 2, serial number 16, and all the other test candidates to come this year. What do you think is the best way to learn something? Lectures? Memorizing formulas? Doing odd-numbered exercises from a textbook? Now, I could show you a bunch of research that shows what the best methods for learning are, but let's be honest, we all know what's the best way to learn something new. You have to love doing it. You learn best while doing and solving in real time, and Brilliant's interactive lessons are based on this principle. You won't need to memorize long, messy formulas and endless facts. Just pick a course you're interested in and get started. Brilliant has something for everybody. Whether you want to start at the basics of math, science, and computer science, or dive into cutting-edge topics like cryptocurrency or quantum computing. I use Brilliant for my own research. If you'd like to join me and a community of 8 million learners and educators today, click the link in the description down below or visit brilliant.org/whataboutit. Today's supporter shoutout goes to Christian Busmann, Roger White, Joe Pons, Rasputin, Philipp Lachmann, and many others. You rock so much. Without you and all the other supporters, What About It would not be possible. Thank you for your support, enjoy today's ad-free release, and remember to join us on the Y Discord server. I am looking forward to thanking you in person. Today's team shoutout goes to Justini and Mr. Astronautical for being such a dedicated part of the Captions team. We're so sorry for having forgotten you on the teams list. This has now been changed. Thank you so much for all your help, and again to the rest of the Captions team as well. You rock. The orbital launch tower and a fuel farm that will be the diggle double from RGV aerial photographer. Diggle double. Give me a moment. I can do this. Yeah. Rule number 15. This can be an indicator. Come on. We'd be talking about another 18 possible launches. Press the test system. Test. Well done. I have to organize my mind. The heck?